I'm Bill Anderson, and I'm the director of the Canadian Center for Scholarship in the Christian Faith. And we want to acknowledge the generous support of Faith Life Financial, who make this annual lecture possible. I know that Karen Berland, the CEO of Faith Life Financial, tried very hard to be here tonight. Unfortunately, she was not able to make it, but she does send her heartfelt, warmest regards to each and every one of you. Now, Nathan has a CD for you. It's only $20 cash. And we hope you have exact change. That would be awesome. And you can purchase that at the table, just over at the back. See our helper waving over there. So that's where you can get that. We, at the Canadian Center for Scholarship in the Christian Faith, believe in God the Father, creator of heaven and earth. He is the supreme artist who sent his Son to redeem artists and gave us a spirit to sanctify our artwork. The Canadian Center for Scholarship in the Christian Faith has a special relationship with the arts. So we warmly invite you to our 2014 conference on the fine arts and the Christian faith. We have the brochure on your seat deck. We believe that scholarship is essential for critically engaging, analyzing, and assessing the arts. And this year we have a very brilliant keynote speaker, Dr. Jean Veith, who has written 20 books on the relationship between culture and the Christian faith. You won't want to miss it. We are also making the call for artists and scholars to make formal presentations at this conference. So you can go to our webpage and sign on there. But it's better, even better, because we're making the call for performance artists. We want to make this conference a festival of art and learning. So there's going to be buskers in the hallways, and poetry readings in the cafeteria, and dancers here in the Tagler. I'm even going to put my tutu on. We're going to have storytellers and improvisers throughout this fine institution. So if you are a performance artist, again, go to our webpage and sign up for that. Okay, the way that the program is going to roll tonight is Nathan will make his presentation, and at the end of it, there'll be 10 minutes for question and answer. So if you have a question, you can put your hand up, and I'll bring the mic over to you. You can ask it, and Nathan will give it his best shot to try and answer it for you. After that, following the whole presentation, please join us for food and refreshments up in the mezzanine, and continue this celebration of art and learning, and enjoy one another as we're all made in the image of God, and He is present today. Before we begin, we would like to acknowledge and thank Leanne Regeer, who is Nathan's accompanist. And Nathan and Leanne have known each other for many years, and they have performed many events together. And you're going to see how well that works here tonight. So we want to say thank you to Leanne. Now, rarely do I have the opportunity to provide a personal introduction to our guest speaker, but tonight I have one Nathan Berg story. You see, I was at Nathan's wedding. And before you get all excited, say, oh, he must be a very important person to be at such a special event as that. No, it's a little more mundane than that. I'm on the Religious Studies Division here at Concordia University, and Nathan is married to our beloved New Testament professor, Dr. N.P. Cho. Indeed, N.P. was instrumental in encouraging and inspiring Nathan to present at this event tonight. So, N.P., we say thank you to you for that, your role in all of this. It was a wonderful wedding. It was full of music from beginning to end, as one can only imagine. And the Spirit of God and the love of God was present. For those of you who know the Berg family, you will know that they are a multi-talented and very loving family. What impressed me about Nathan Berg, however, was not his powerful voice, nor his technical skill, though he possesses those in abundance. Rather, it was his humility. He could have stolen the show, he could have blown us all away, but he didn't do that. He sang with his family and for his beloved and he. and it was hopelessly romantic. Just like God's love for each and every one of us. So now, please enjoy an evening with Nathan Berg, opera, and the Christian faith.
Good evening. I suppose I shouldn't just talk like this. I'll use the mic. Now, you're going to have to put up with me doing something which is somewhat rare in my experience. Most of the time, I have great composers writing all the words that I'm supposed to be performing. So I will try and do my best. Now, I have a puzzle for you. Oops, I've got to turn this on. Here we go. How does someone go, from this to, now brace yourself, this, and still remain the same person? Tonight I'm going to tell you a little bit about the journey that I've gone through in my life and how my faith has been there in this journey. I have been a professional singer for quite a long time now, and even though it might seem that I've been one forever and that this was my vocation, that it was my calling, which it very much seems to be, there were many things that drew me to this point, that put me in this place. The possibilities of different tracks a person's life can go through in any situation is mind-boggling. Even in this seemingly finite world of classical singing. And even with all of the experience that I've had and all of the attempts that I have in trying to direct my life in one direction or another and keep control, I'm constantly reminded how little I actually am in charge of things. My faith has been more vital to me than I even ever realized it would be. In my youth, I remember thinking about my faith as being something that would be a requirement, an obligation as a Christian, that I would go out and be a witness to my faith in the world, and that this would be something which would be a sacrifice and a lot of work and would take from me. I wouldn't necessarily have been thinking this consciously or saying this out loud, but I remember having that feeling of it being something that would require a lot of me. In the end, the reality is that it's given to me far, far more than I ever could have given it or given out because I'm a Christian. The tools that I have needed as a performer on the road are exactly what my faith has provided for me. The mental and emotional tools of actually surviving in a situation where I'm away from stability and structure and all of these sorts of things, and to deal with all of the variety of different people that I meet on the road, is exactly what the love and understanding that I learned through my upbringing and my faith provided for me. Now, most of you probably are aware that I come from a tight-knit pastor's family. There's my dad, the pastor, my mom, pastor number two, my sister Joy, who's a professor here at the college, my brothers, and me. I don't know if I want to say much about them. here, let's cute this up a little bit. There we go. That's me, the one that's actually looking into the camera. Family life is always full of stresses and conflict and negotiation and all of these sorts of things that in and of itself teach how to cope in the world. And this, with the context of the faith environment that I grew up with, was the perfect environment to bring me into a job which actually required so much of me on the road like this. Our family often would sing together. I, being the baby of the family, which I suppose I still am, would be up singing in front of the church. And when people would ask me what I wanted to be when I grew up, I would usually say a singer, even though obviously I had no idea what that would entail growing up. And I suppose I didn't really know until I actually was one. But so then I grew up. I started learning some songs, and I remember working on German and English songs in particular, and thinking that while singing these pieces, I remember having this thought that I could do this as a profession. I could be a professional singer, and thinking about this is quite remarkable because. By that point, I had never actually heard a professional singer, classical singer, singing live. I had no idea. And I can only think that it was divine inspiration at that time that gave me that conviction that I was going to be a classical singer at some point in time. Two songs that caught my attention at that point were often Schubert and Vaughan Williams and these sorts of composers at that point. So we're going to perform now for you Frühlingsglaube by Schubert. Spring Belief, Spring Faith, and Silent Noon by Vaughan Williams.
Thank you. Sun-searched growths, the dragonfly hangs like a blue thread loosened from the sky. So this winged hour is dropped to us.
This is a very different thing, speaking between singing. Anyway, so I was a high school student in Camrose thinking about being a singer. And I had no idea what that would entail to actually go about being a singer. So I set about putting myself into situations where I seem to be shrinking, where God where God could open doors if he so saw fit. I spent a year at CLBI and then CLC, now Augustana in Camrose. I went to Western Ontario, to London, the University of Western Ontario in London, Ontario, for a year, and then some unexpected things started to happen. I basically, out of the blue, after being accepted for Juilliard in London, I got the opportunity to have a fully paid trip to go to France to study in Versailles. This led directly to my connection with Vera Rocha, who became my teacher, who is one of the most legendary singing teachers of the 20th century. She's taught all kinds of biggies of the opera world, and I just so happened just to fall into that through that connection. She connected me to the Guildhall School in London, where I studied. There I got my connections for professional work, and which started there. And even one of the seeming failures at the time, where I came in second in a competition in London, led to my first manager, because one of the jurors in the competition that I was in was so annoyed that I hadn't won that she contacted her manager, who then contacted me and took me on. So, and all this while, even as professional work started to come in, I kept on thinking, you know, I'm not going to say that I'm going to do this job. I'm still seeing where it's going. Let's see if God keeps opening up some doors. And he kept on opening up the doors, and I thought, okay, I can always change paths. I'm still young. Anyway, he kept on going, and here I am, still arguably young. And along this path, the idea of actually singing opera had to develop out of nowhere. I remember that the only contact that I had with opera while I was growing up seemed to be when I accidentally changed the channels on the radio and it fell on a station that was broadcasting something operatic. And I seem to remember feeling that, hearing tenors painfully singing something that felt unnatural. And that's the only thing I knew about opera at the time. But thankfully, eventually, my love of communicating with my voice led me to this world where you inhabit characters and you bring large groups of people together in an amazing unifying experience. That brings me to the thought about music in general. I'm losing my train of thought, but that age-old philosophical problem of the human condition, where we wonder whether we really know what's going on in somebody else's brain, that can be one of the most disturbing thing for people, and it's been a struggle that people have faced for many, many centuries, if not forever. And I think this is why God gave us music, this unifying force that I feel when I'm singing in opera, and especially through music. This, to me, is the reason why God gave us music, because, and the arts in general, I suppose, because with words we can only go so far, and with music there is something in it that really pulls people's minds together without it being a definable force. I often find myself singing, realizing that with this feeling that I'm involved in something that I don't really have the power to really do myself, that it's beyond my powers what's coming out of my mouth. And I feel like I'm kind of a witness to something that God is creating and this unifying force that's happening. So this is something remarkably special in my career. So now I find myself singing opera and being characters on stage that I would not necessarily want to emulate their personalities much. I think about my ancestors, what they would think of me being on stage like this, a lot of these conservative people. I also think about that in this process of going through all of this in my life, that it wasn't only my own faith that was the force that kept me grounded. It was also other people's faith. My parents, to be able to trust that God would be able to keep me safe in a world which is so completely out of their comfort zone, and not really give me the impression that they were all that terribly concerned. I remember one conversation on the phone with Mum before I was about to perform in Paris. I was going to be Pluto, Jupiter, and Neptune in a production in Paris. A very un-Lutheran thing to do. And I remember talking to Mum, and she's saying, remember, this isn't real. Well, that's as far as her concern went. One of the less than admirable characters, I suppose, that I've performed many times is Leporello. And in the role, the aria Madamina, which is one of the first things I ever learned as an opera singer, is what we're going to be doing next. So Leporello himself, he's caught in this world where he's stuck with his boss's immoral, power-hungry situation. He gets pulled between admiration and revulsion. And in this aria, he's, I suppose, more, unfortunately, admiring his boss's conquests, where he says to the most recent conquest that, in fact, you're only one of several thousand. Which include royalty and peasants and rich and poor and old and young alike and people from all different countries. At one point, I'll be singing Mille Traits, or look for that. That's when I'm saying that there was 1,003 in Spain alone.
Grande maestro
La piccina, ognor vezzosa, delle vecchie fa conquista per piacer di porle in lista. Sua passion predominante è la giovin principiante. Non si picca se sia ricca, se sia brutta, se sia bella, se sia ricca, brutta, se sia bella, purché porti la gonnella. Voi sapete quel che fa. Voi sapete quel che fa, purché porti la gonnella. Voi sapete quel che fa. Voi sapete quel che fa.
Just about forgot my handy fancy tool here. Now, only part of what I do in my career is operatic. I am often on stage, the situation usually is with an orchestra and choir and four soloists, for example, Handel's Messiah. And these concert situations are dominated by music that was inspired by the Christian faith. And so, as a Christian, I have a unique situation that I actually am performing music which is a part of my life. I've had opportunities to perform this music in many interesting places. One of the most remarkably memorable situations was I actually was able to sing Handel's Messiah and a Bach cantata where I was singing the words of Jesus in Jerusalem, which is pretty amazing, actually, to actually be able to be characters on stage in Messiah and actually be speaking the words of Jesus within a half a mile of where he was and where these words would have been spoken. Not all of my colleagues, obviously, come from the same place that I do, and so they're not connected to the music, this music, the way that I would. So I get a special thing in these situations. But I always, when I'm performing this music, I always hope that God can speak through me in these situations as well. Bach, the next composer will show you now, one of my most favorite composers to sing, but though one of the most difficult, is one of the most amazing experiences I have in music. Bach is has written this incredible transcendent music that really gets to the heart of things in a way that you imagine being performed in the greatest situations. I was reading the other day that, what's his name? Isaiah Berlin, the philosopher, had a comment once that Bach, if the angels, if they're going to perform for God himself, they'll perform Bach. If they're performing for each other, they'll perform Mozart. which makes total sense to me. But this next piece, now it actually displays how my faith actually, it displays how my faith works in my life, in the text itself, showing how my faith can actually bring me peace and stability in a situation, in a world, and in a life which is unstable on its own.
Selig zu.
Hier muss ich das Herz.